Okay, let's talk about some creative gating techniques for drum loops and grooves. As we've talked about many times before, you want to avoid that sort of plug and play use of loops. Many guys are using the same loop libraries, so it's important to edit and modify your loops to ensure they are your own. You know this, we've talked about this. One way of doing that is to use some gating, clever gating. The simple outcome of this trick is cool on its own, but the next level of it makes for some amazing sounds. In this example, we're going to use more of a hip-hop sounding groove. Hip-hop grooves are mostly broken beat flavors at slower tempos. Now that said, think about using this technique for any other broken beat flavors like dubstep or breakbeat or drum and bass even. Okay, first of all, let's have a listen to the three channels making up this groove. All I've done really so far is just grab some loops off some loop libraries and audition them against each other to make sure that they're cohesive and that they sound good together. So here's our overall groove. All right, and let's look at each loop and why it was chosen. All right, that one's got the big kick and the kind of clap, that actual backbone feel to it. Here was one that's a little more sparse. Right, so it complements this main groove. I'm getting that more driving hi-hat kind of flavor to it. And then here was the hi-hat that I chose. I actually found this and programmed it on UltraBeat just to show a little diversity between using audio and MIDI. All three together. Right? So we've talked a little bit about this before too, and I don't want to get too distracted, but part of making a good dance track or part of making a track that has a groove that plays nice together is really just a matter of selection. Taking the time to really audition things and make sure that they're going to work together. Now, I didn't get too crazy with reprogramming or turning these into Rex files or anything like that. These are just plug and play grooves, but we're going to take them to the next level to make sure that they don't sound like they were just slapped in. Here's a really quick aside, because if you watched my last tutorial series, the Insider Secrets Volume 1, we talked a lot about gain staging, particularly of audio files. One thing I want to show you here real quick is instead of using a gain plugin to drop these things down, I went over here and just dropped them down in the actual track inspector. I dropped each one of these louder audio files down minus 5 dB to ensure headroom at the channel. You'll notice that we're also in pre-fader metering mode, okay? So again, I'm looking at what's actually coming into the channel pre-fader. And if you look at the faders over here, we're going to see that we have nice healthy levels coming in. Again, this really sets us up for success down the road. This padding of sounds really ensures good headroom, especially in the very first session. If you don't do this, you're going to be turning things down, and it just becomes a mess. When you go to mix, you have to start from scratch. Try to do these little things up front to make sure to save yourself a lot of headaches. Okay, just look at these levels real quick. Bring up the mixer. All right, pretty healthy. And you'll notice I do have a little bit of a mastering chain in place. That's just to give a little more pump, just to kind of excite things a little bit as I'm working through the track. Now, let's look at this trigger channel over here. Ah, this is where things start to get a little more interesting. Right here, what I've done is I've simply brought up an EXS24. I went to the factory sounds and brought up a woodblock patch. And with that woodblock patch, what I did, all I simply did was grabbed the hi-hat data here. Obviously, this is not in use. But I grabbed this hi-hat data and simply dragged it down to this new track here. Well, why does it look totally different? Well, again, if you watched my last series, we talked a little bit about using the transform window to create randomization in velocity, pitch, and even timing. Just really quickly, one more time, what I do is I grab this data, I go to MIDI transform, I bring up this one, random pitch, velocity, and length. Over here, I determine the range of velocities I want it to randomize, and then I select and operate. I'll actually go ahead and select and operate just a couple more times for you so you can see what the randomization actually is pumping out. I really enjoy doing this sort of stuff. It's almost like having another band member, someone to bring something fresh and interesting to your groove. That randomization can go a long way. It can also be very non-musical. It can not work in a lot of cases, but let's see why in this particular case it's actually going to work for me. I'm going to solo that and let's just have a listen to what it sounds like. All All right, now that's pretty much garbage, right? And on top of it, I find that it's hitting on every 16th note, which I don't want. So I'm gonna get rid of this one. I'm gonna get rid of this one, get rid of this one. Again, I'm just kind of complimenting the randomization that it's spitting out by giving it some of my own randomization. And now, all right, cool. Cool enough, easy, simple. Following me so far? Now what we're going to do is we're going to set this woodblock sound to be a sidechain trigger, a ghost chain trigger. Now, again, I tend to refer to my earlier videos. So if you haven't seen Produce Signature EDM, where we talk in detail about ghost chaining, you might want to check those videos out. We're not going to hear this trigger. What we're going to do is we're going to turn this trigger off. And how we do that is I'm going to send it to a bus. Well, I already have this bus 2 set up here. And now bus 2 is going to accept that sound. I'm going to solo bus 2 and we'll just go ahead and listen to it. Right now, again, it's still garbage. What are we going to do with this? This has no business in our track. It would sound god awful against these other loops, right? What we're going to do is we're going to set this to no output. And when we set this now to no output, we don't hear it. But as you can see, the signal is still happening sort of behind the scenes. That's why we call it a ghost trigger. Now, where are we going with this? What's the idea here? Well, I'm going to go ahead and bring up the mixer one more time, and we're going to take, turn the solo off here. We're going to take all three of these oranges right here, which are the three beat elements I have going, and I'm going to send all those to a summing channel. Okay, now on that sum channel now, if I solo that, we'll hear all three of the stems. Okay, pretty straightforward. Now, here's what we're going to do. I've brought up this noise gate, okay? Now this noise gate, I'm gonna turn it on, and what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna play that groove and adjust the threshold, and we're gonna see how basically all it's doing is it's gonna chop the tails of this loop here. So as you can see, here are the major spikes, here are the major transients, right? But for instance, this longy right here, this long dude right here and this long dude right here, we're gonna start chopping those tails off by adjusting the threshold. So let's have a listen. Right, so as the threshold goes closer to 0 dB, we're really chopping what is able to come through here. I'm gonna render all this down as its own new audio file. Let me go ahead and do that and I'll be right back. Okay, so now we've rendered down those chops, that kind of gated version of this loop with the tighter tails. Now what I'm gonna do is I'm actually going to take this a step further and we're gonna take this groove and its little shortened tails and we're going to use this as sort of a clever little turnaround, say for the end of a phrase, at the end of like an 8-measure phrase or a 16-measure phrase or something like that, to create interest as a dropout before the beat comes back in. So how are we gonna do that? We're going to go to convert and we're going to convert to new sampler track. So what it's going to do is it's going to read it by transient markers, which are all very, very clearly defined transient markers. We're gonna hit okay. Logic's gonna think for a second and it's gonna spit out one of these Rex files that we're oh so familiar with at this point. Now, if we look, again, it looks like a chromatic scale, but in reality, what it is each one of these slices is one of those hits. Right? So now let's listen to what's coming off of EXS24. It'll be exactly what we had here with the audio. Right? So now here's how we're going to take this further, though. We're going to select all of these. We're going to go to MIDI transform. I'm going to randomize the velocities. And I'm going to randomize them between 90 and 127. I find that to be a pretty good range. Make sure that they're loud enough, but that the quieter ones are noticeably quieter. I'm going to hit select and operate. Hitting select and operate is a bit redundant. If I say select only, it just selects them. And if I say operate only, it just operates only. But in this case, it doesn't matter if it's exactly redundant. I'm just going to hit select and operate. Boom. And it's randomizing these velocities. So I'm going to show you a little closer here so you can see. See how it's randomizing the velocities? Obviously, those yellower tones are the lighter velocities, and the harder red ones are higher velocities. I'm going to go all the way down to, say, 70 on this and really make it a point to show you the range. So now we're getting into these greens here. Okay, so now, obviously, the greenies are going to be a little more quieter, and the red ones are going to be a lot hotter. So let's have a listen. right? So now what we're going to do is we're going to go over to EXS24, and we're going to set up an internal modulation here. We're going to say that the pan, left and right, is being controlled by the velocity. So what's happening is these velocity differences are going to cause each slice to get panned left or right. So I'm going to crank this all the way up, and this will probably be best in headphones, but have a listen. Right? So in a loop like this, it's not that busy. It doesn't do that much, but that's a good thing because I'll show you what the next step for this little turnaround, this little clever little turnaround thing is going to be. We're just going to solo this now rexed version of the cutaway loop. I'm going to send it to a new bus. Okay. And then on that bus, I'm going to use one of my user channel strip settings for stereo delay. Now I'm going to route this out to the stereo delay and send it just a little bit and we'll see what it does. Kind of cool, right? And on the stereo delay, I'm actually going to choose this kind of telephone notch effect. And I'm going to ease up on it just a little bit because I do want to make sure that it's nice and crispy. Right? And then on the actual turnaround section, I'm going to bring up an EQ and I'm going to dial out some lows. So it feels a little less heavy in that section. So let's just have a listen to what's happening there. Right? Now I'm not going to use all of this. The idea here is to do this sort of thing. Right? Let's even try a different, little busier sort of effect on the delay. Let's see if we can get, let's see what this pluck spread. I use this on plucks for trance tunes, but let's see if it goes a little haywire for us. Or even something a little bit more like a eighth note triplet over on this side. Or even, I think that one's about the best. So you've got your groove. So several things are happening there, right? The actual original hits have their tails sort of cut off. They're being routed left and right for just that measure. And the groove itself here is being high-passed a little bit on its own channel. Then it's being sent off to a stereo delay. That stereo delay is being EQ'd pretty heavily. Let's try a different EQ curve for this. Maybe something more like this. Right? And then it's going through this stereo delay, which you can tune to your liking. But this is just a really cool way of using recursive functions, turning the groove back onto itself, editing it and reshaping it and reforming it to keep life and interest in it. Okay, so we've looked at cool ways to use the outcome of the groove that was simply summed and then gated for these cool turnaround effects. Now let's look at using that trigger we set up to control the gate that we put on the summing channel. Now I've taken the liberty of extending the groove out here and leaving our green turnaround section at the end of the phrase like you would have in virtually any type of programmed music. Sometimes it's easy to forget that hip hop really is electronic music. It doesn't always get lumped into EDM as we know it, but it's hard to find hip hop tracks that don't make use of a lot of electronic dance music techniques. So anyway, now we have something a little bit more of an arrangement happening here. But we're going to take this a step further. Now, just really quickly, I have taken the liberty also of throwing a compressor on this turnaround groove here. I like the Studio FET a lot for drums. That's just a little quick tip. And I've eased up on the mix just to kind of keep that original tonality in place, but still compressing it. Okay, moving on. What we're now going to do is I want you to look at the mixer here and look how we're set up. We have all three of these orange drum tracks being sent to bus one. And here it says sum. Now on sum, we have the gate. Now so far, this gate has not been set to anything. It was actually set to none, correct? But what we're going to do now is we're going to go ahead and actually set it to the woodblock trigger. Okay. Now what's happening is this woodblock trigger is not being heard. Remember? So if I solo that trigger, nothing, right? But what we're doing now is we're telling the noise gate that's on this sum here for the other drums, we're telling it, listen to what's happening on bus two. And that would be this pink section here with all these random velocities and all these random cuts. I might even go so far as to randomize them further just so I have a longer phrase of randomization to work with. But all three of these are now going to be listening to what's coming off this pink. And the gate is doing exactly that. The gate is gating what's coming off that pink. Now, let's just go ahead and have a listen as I adjust the threshold. Which is really, really cool when all is said and done. You're kind of leaning towards a more progressive hip-hop sound. A lot of times hip-hop beats or certain broken flavors, you write your groove, you use it, you ride it or whatever. You don't want to necessarily write crazy more rhythms. You don't need additional grooves and polyrhythms and drum fills galore. You don't need that kind of stuff. What you do like sometimes is a little bit of interest and detail and motion in the actual lines that were programmed in the first place. So you're getting that using this noise gate. Now, one step further, what are we going to do? You guessed it. We're going to automate the heck out of this threshold right here for a little bit more interest and detail coming off the line. Once again, I'm going to open up the mixer. I'm going to go to sum. I'm going to tell Logic I want to see that track in the arrange window by saying create track. Now here's my sum track. And I'm going to bring up this noise gate. And on this sum here, I'm going to go ahead and put it on touch mode. And then I'm going to just simply hit play and start messing with the threshold. Noting that this green is not going to be affecting anything right here. Okay, the green is obviously its own entity. We programmed that in the last video. Just a quick note. Okay, putting this back in. Actually, let's go even a little bit more hog wild here, because I want you to understand that we're still dealing with an envelope. All sounds in nature have an attack, decay, sustain, and release. What we're going to do here is we're going to adjust the release times. So that's basically how long it takes the gate to recover from the slice that it's done. All right, so I'm going to adjust the release as well. Now, I've got this interplay happening between the threshold and the release. Now, I'm going to go ahead and put this back in read mode so I don't accidentally touch anything else and ruin it. And I get this really cool outcome. All I did was program some basic beats, but now all of a sudden, they're very unique and they're very special to me. I might, if I was programming this and really writing a song here, I would be very, very tempted to take this main beat off the groove send it simply to the stereo output, and use it more as a backbone, use it more as an unaffected backbone groove. Everything else on top can get a little bit more fluttery and have some more motion to it. Let's just listen to what happens if we do that. Without the main beat, right, so we're getting a little bit more motion and interest and kind of randomization and glitchiness to it, but not at the expense of the groove. We still have this nice kind of solid backbone-y groove that someone could rap on, that you could start to write bass lines on. It's simply going to function. Last thing I'm going to show you as far as more sound design on this thing is, since we have that sum channel going and we've got that gate on there, let's go and do something kind of fun with it and bring up a distortion. Now, I could use one of Logic's distortions, any of these are all legit and fun in their different uses. But let's go to amps and pedals, and we're going to go to the pedal board. And I think a lot of people tend to think of this as simply being a guitar player's tool. Not the case. Pedals are awesome in any recording art situation because they're specialized and they have their own voice and you can bring them in and audition them. What I've done is I've created a user patch where it's all distortions. So this is all the distortions that come on the pedal board. Now what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna audition them one at a time and see if there's anything on there that I think goes to town. I already love that. I'm in love with that. I think that's totally working. I'm really feeling that. Now, if you were in a situation where you wanted to ease up on the amount of that being used, you guessed it, buses to buses. One of my favorite things to do is send a bus to a bus. So we're effectively affecting the effects. How do you like that? We're gonna take this pedal thing, we're gonna move it over here instead. We're going to take that sum and we're going to send it gently to the pedals. We're gonna say pedals over here. So here's that solo pedal. Right, so I'm really feeling that. I think that what's happening with these two lines here, this beat support and this hi-hat, they're getting crunchier, obviously. They're getting that little bit of sense of distortion on there, but one drum hit in particular almost begins to sound like a tom, and we're getting a little bit of like a tonality to it. It almost sounds like it's sort of in a key. Something like that can end up really complementing whatever sort of bassline you're writing. Okay, last thing, and I could go on forever with this because you can do this same trick with a few other elements, but what I've done here is I've brought up a pad, okay? So this is really our first sort of harmonic element in the track, and all I've done here was program in a really simple chord. Super easy, coming off of retro synth. Now, let's just go ahead and listen to that pad in the context of the track. Kind of garbage, right? Doesn't really do anything. Well, you guessed it. We're going to pull up that another noise gate. We're going to put a noise gate as an insert on the channel of that pad. We're going to set that pad to receive its trigger, its sidechain trigger, from that woodblock trigger that we set up in video one. And we're gonna turn this on and tune the threshold and the release and see what we got. I'm actually going to set the release really tight here real quick. And let's just go ahead and see now what this sidechain gate is going to do for our pad. Super, super dope. Totally feeling that. Now, let me give you one last really cool idea to play with, especially if you're a composer and you really like to write a lot of lines. Let's say you wrote a fairly rhythmic melodic line, okay? Like it's got a lot of notes and it's got a kind of a specific rhythmic element to it. Could actually even be like a chord stab line that you've written, something really percussive, but something really busy. What you do is you take that line, that melodic line or something like that, and you render it down and simply dump it on a woodblock channel. And then you use that woodblock trigger to, say, duck your pads or gate your drum groove or even gate, say, your white noise risers or something like that. So what's happening is you're recursively laying the track's element back on itself in a very, very hidden, sneaky way. You're taking, say, whatever melodic line was written in the tune, and you're sneaking it back into the track as actually a ghost trigger. So, say, whatever rhythmic line the vocal had is now triggering and cutting on and off something like white noise, or cutting on and off something like a pad. Okay? So, hopefully that's not too abstract for you, but that's my little advanced insider end of the lesson trick for you guys to chew on. All right, so I hope you learned something about this gating stuff. We went pretty deep into it. Start slow, try something that you know is gonna work, then build it up. Go through these one at a time. Don't necessarily have to get super deep into this. More complex does not mean better music. We all know that, but this should give you a real wide range of techniques to draw from when it comes to clever gating.